Hello, welcome to Hot Issues. This week, a group of GRIDCO staff groups went on a sit-down strike in demand of huge amounts of debt that are owed GRIDCO, which they claim could cripple the company. But they have suspended the strike, but the consequences of this are here with us. I'm privileged to have with me the representative of GRIDCO Senior Staff Association, Raphael Kono, and my dear friend, Kojopoku, an energy analyst. Gentlemen, thanks for having you on Hot Issues. Let me start with you, Mr. Kono. The declared strike, you've suspended it. Give us a reason why you suspended it.
Well, thank you very much, Stephen. And my good friend, Kojo, right. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Well, we did embark on the sit-down strike. And we had an engagement with our management running for 2 days for us to come to a settlement. We had some assurances from our management and maybe one or two responses from some of the institutions that we have petitioned. And so our management appealed to us to suspend the strikes while they make sure they also pursue those assurances given to them by affected institutions.
So would you say that these assurances that we're giving to you are firm enough to enable you to suspend, or there are conditions for which if those assurances don't come you would go back to strike, since you just suspended, really, you didn't call off?
Well, we want to give our management the benefit of the doubt, and you know, in crisis you look at the situations and then you take a decision. And so even though there were no cogent assurance as to how much of those monies will be paid, we trust that some effort that they assured that will be made good. I mean, they will deliver on those promises.
Mr. Boku, you were in absolute disagreement with the decision to go on strike. Are you surprised that eventually the GRIDCO staff groups decided to suspend this declared strike?
We don't condone and we don't want to set a precedent where workers are going on strike, because that could have a domino effect. I think the right thing has to be done, which is when you have grievances as a worker, you go to your management and your management will take it up with the power that be.
Which is what they did.
Which is what they've done now. Which is what management has asked them to basically suspend, and they've suspended. But what I'm adding to the conversation is that it is not suspended because nothing has been done. As of Tuesday, they have been given a substantial amount of money by ECG, and assurances has been given.
And you know this for a fact.
I know this for a fact.
And you have confirmation of that.
I have this confirmation for a fact that monies were paid to them on Tuesday, and it is that money
so
that was paid to them.
So the staff groups of GRIDCO will have no reason. You think that they should call it off?
Well, you see, I think they should call it off. They have a right to suspend it because their demands, which for me, I think will be difficult to achieve, is being looked at. But for me, the dialogue is very important. There are two issues, and I clearly want us to separate it. The issue, do they have an issue to complain about? Yes, they do. Okay, if you have an institution like GRIDCO and monies that they invoice, is not the full amount is not being paid, and is more or less under recovery when every bit of it is paid weekly, there's a concern. Secondly, my rejection of this whole thing is the quorum that is complaining, which is the workers, not the management that's complaining. So for me, I have a view that, I hold a view, and most of my friends in the civil society hold a view that the workers, we don't want to encourage, because if we
but
do
that's
go
why
that
Mr.
line...
Mr. Kono might agree with you that as people who are in that institution and they work for the group, if the company is starved of finances or resources and they get the sense that management is failing to pursue the options that will bring the indebtedness down, they have a right to express their
well
view.
Then for
and
me
they have a right to express that view strongly, leading to a strike.
Well, yes, but then that case management had failed, and then when management fails they have to be removed, if that's the line we want to go on. So clearly we don't want to go that path in doing an indictment that management has failed, and because of their failure workers have to resort to a strike. We don't want to do that. But if we go on that tangent, that if they feel strongly that there's a problem, I have gone further to say that, look, because of the monies that we know goes to GRIDCO, though it's been said that that makes up about 20% of their overall revenue, those monies are substantive enough for GRIDCO, not for their workers to go around and feel that there is no money for hotels and needed tools and stuff like that.
Mr. Kono, you disagree with that because you say a lot of the money that come to you are used in running your operations and sometimes you have nothing to get by. Is that the case?
Yes, Stephen, rightly so. But let me address one or two issues that my friend Kojo raised here. You see, Kojo said he's emphatic.
Yeah.
That Tuesday, money has been paid to Greco. And along the line, he said they are addressing the issues. So there is some...
So which is which?
Which is which?
There are conflicting
yes,
claims.
Because yeah. As at yesterday, and one of the basis upon which we suspend our strike was a letter given to us from ECG that our petition is being addressed. Nothing has been stated that some monies have been paid.
Mm.
And so I don't know where Kojo had the information from. If he can mention the amount, because he spoke emphatic on the matter. And so maybe he's privy to what I don't know.
Mm.
Yes.
But as far as you know, no such assurances have come, like in terms of assurance to pay X amount or Y amount. But you've been given assurances that the issues will be resolved.
Yeah, yes. Let me just say that ECG, normally they do weekly payment.
Mm.
They were doing 9 million, somewhere 5 million. But the assurance we had from our management, that the engagement they had with them, they are going to up their weekly payment to 15 million, 14 million a week. And so if that is what Kojo is saying, it's an assurance that they are going to pay. And so I don't know whether...
But it's not a clear indication that any money is going to come in. That's what you're saying.
Well, bulk money, as we demanded that they should pay the PDS money, that one, I can't vouch here that money has been paid. And per the letter we cited, which formed the basis of our suspension, is an open letter that seek to say, oh, we are looking at the issues.
More like bare rhetoric without any commitment. Mr. Boku,
Let's separate it into three. Per their first letter they put in the public domain, and let's educate your viewers. Mm. They asked for $600 and something million, which is more or less, if we can call it, a legacy debt, something that was there pre March 1st, 2019. Mm. Then they also asked for a $94 million, which they said was in place when PDS just exited. Then they are now asking for monies owed to them by ECG since ECG took over the middle of
not just by ECG, ECG, Valco.
No, we are really talking Netco. About ECG now, not
okay.
Netco and Valco.
Okay.
So let's restrict ourselves to ECG, who is the most active player in this industry and has resources to basically pay. So the 604 or the over $600 million, that is not the money I'm saying that was paid on Tuesday. That money, that debt sits with Ministry of,
debt.
It's a legacy debt sits with Ministry of Finance, and I'm sure at the right time the government will make provisions to make sure that some money is fine for Gridco.
Mm.
The 94 or the 90 odd million dollars that they are asking for sits with reconciliation. When ECG took over from PDS, there's supposed to be a reconciliation of when the PDS was in office. When all that reconciliation is done, then there's a clean handover from PDS to ECG. That money which is sitting there, they will be paid the 90 odd million of that, and they'll be paid. The money I'm saying that's been paid them is the money he mentioned, which is the weekly payment, which was there saying that it's too small. So now what ECG has decided is that, look, let's not be doing the odd 5 billion and 9 million, but doing a bigger chunk of amount, so that if we're doing a weekly of, let's say, 14 million, as he mentioned, then we now end up with 4 times 14. We end up with something like 56 million a month, which is much
substantial
than what they were doing the 5 and the 9. So what I'm saying is that there was a weekly money going to Gridco, and we've mentioned that over and over. The challenge that the workers are pointing out, that money is meager, it's not enough to attend to their work that they need to do. So now that we've had that assurance that the money will be up from the 5 to 9 to the 14, I'm hoping that will continue, and by the end of the month they will be getting something like $56 million.
Mm.
Sorry, 56 million Ghana cedis, which will be substantive for what they need to do.
Let's come to a common agreement. Where do we draw the line between how much is owed Gridco and whether they can keep afloat and can keep operating with these debts out there whilst the staff are agitating for the debts to be totally cleared? We're creating the impression as if they can manage without these debts. Is that what it is? That you can manage operating without the sums, various sums of money owed you from ECG and Valco and Netco and the rest, and still be all right?
No, that is the cry of the workers. And for me, I think could you mention that the 20% of power that we sell to those outside the box supply,
should be like, able to keep your operations.
I disagree totally.
Why?
He runs an institution. Mm. If 100% of your revenue and 80% is somewhere, 20%, are you sure you can use it to run your institution? Look, the 20% he's talking about, Newmont is part, some other institutions are part. They are just consuming some small power. Now, Newmont has constructed, finance, a substation, and a line, dedicated line to them. And those things are used to repay those debts. So, indirectly, the money is not coming to Greco. Mm. And so, Kojo should rather advocate for Greco, so that at least he should do an advocacy for Greco, so that Greco will be financially
Talking about.
And so, that 20% alone cannot run Greco.
Mm. Let's talk about what you just mentioned, advocacy to ensure that Greco becomes financially sustainable. Is Greco financially unstable?
Of course, that is the cry of the workers. Because if you owe your service providers, you have debts with service, you couldn't meet your counterpart funding on some projects, and the projects have stalled. The 330 project, which is going to be more or less the backbone and eventually carry power through to Burkina Faso, to Mali. That is a major project for this country. We have another project running from Tema to Achimota, which is also going to stabilize the system. Because remember, our load is growing by every year.
Yeah.
And Greco has to invest in the infrastructure that they have. They have to upgrade the lines. They have to change towers. Every now and then, Greco has something to do. And it's capital intensive.
Mr. Boko, upgrade lines, change towers, capital intensive operation. You're still not convinced.
I'm very convinced. Now, you see, let's not make it sound that I am not on the part of Greco needs to be resourced. I am on the part that Greco needs to be resourced. My challenge, and like I said earlier, is that the message is right, but the messenger who is carrying the message is the wrong messenger. What I'm saying is that if there is a need for agitation, management should agitate, not workers. I don't want to condone that precedent, because we can have a domino effect of other companies also taking the lead, where every worker can get up and go on strike. When they compare their strike with teachers and nurses are advocating or striking for better salaries and better benefits. They are not doing that. They are only advocating that the company should be resourced. Now, let's move on to the point that he makes. Yes, but let's ask ourselves one question. Anytime they've done a major infrastructure project, who guarantees the financing? It's government. Greco has never borrowed on their balance sheet, because the balance sheet is not healthy. So every time they've done the 330 or the counterpart funding that he talks of, that guarantee of that money is government, Ministry of Finance. So the bottom line is that the person that you are saying owe you is ECG. Who is the biggest indebtor to ECG?
Government.
Government. Government is the one that also guarantees your major infrastructure. So for me, I think that going forward, their management, the MD, the CFO, should have a very better engagement with Ministry of Finance on what is the way forward. I am privy to the fact that they want to convert some of these short-term debts to long-term debts. So they want to probably bond the debt and probably raise some money. We did that with the ESLA. Money came in, but the ESLA fund has not been basically filled up enough for us to go back into the market and raise money under ESLA because of the CD to the dollar problem. Mm. So now there is the thought that Ministry of Finance needs to go back out there, raise some money to clear some of these debt, including giving some substantial money to Greco. But before that is done, I'm sure Ministry of Finance will want to sit with Greco and net off. And from the thought of Ministry of Finance, when they net off with Greco, Greco will end up owing them. But that's not to say that they shouldn't get their money. If Valco owes them, they should get their money. If Netco owes them, they should get their money. That is what will make them plan. For now, I'm sure as a company, they can't plan. Because if you don't have money, how do you plan? But for me, the fundamental is that if they have grievances, it should be channeled through the right process. We can all come together and put pressure on government to make sure that Greco is putting the right step. But they should not be the one going on strike.
You should not be the ones going on strike. How does that sound to you?
My friend Kojo, I think you've lost on that. You see, this is a company that, look, is on the heart of
Greco the staff.
Let me tell Kojo that some of us didn't start with Greco. Some of us started with Vinyari. And we were in the Department of Transmission. And so that is how can we were maintained in that department. Mm. And we know the history of this transmission company. Mm. And so if you are saying that staff shouldn't be at the forefront in demanding for their debt, It means you are telling them that we shouldn't be committed to our own company. Look, staff shouldn't be complaining of their stomach only. You understand? You have a hen that lay a golden egg. Do you want that hen to die? Where will you get the egg to eat? And so that is why staff are saying, look, we'll forget of our stomach. We'll fight and then make sure that the hen is properly fed so that it will continue to lay the golden egg for the staff and for Mother Ghana. And that is why staff have put themselves out there to make sure that these things are addressed. For staff to get up and be fighting for this company, I think Kojo should rather commend the staff, and other staff should also follow suit in demanding that, look, their institutions that they are working for survived.
Mr. Poku, you are supposed to be commending the staff, Great Coast
staff.
Well,
it's like telling me that an armed robber came to my house, I caught him, and I killed him. It's my money he stole. I killed him instead of handing him over to
authority. I don't see the comparison.
The comparison is taking the matters into your own hands. That's the comparison. If your own property is taken, you're not supposed to do anything with the person who took your own property. You're supposed to hand him over to the state. The reason we have that process is because we want to keep law and order. If everybody starts agitating because they feel that something is happening, we'll have anarchy. And the reason we have the peace and the law and order in this country is because we can't take matters into our own hands.
So do you think they have a case? That's the point.
Well, yes, they do.
They have a case. They're justified for wanting to save their company from strangulating.
Look, for me, I think a demonstration is in order. A strike, I don't agree. If they want to go out and demonstrate, why not? They can demonstrate. But to strike, you know what it means for Gridco to strike? If Gridco now is on strike and there's a tender, and some line, there's lightning hit a line, and part of the country goes off. What Gridco does is that they shut the whole system down and bring it up gradually so that they balance the frequency on the system. The minute that happens and Gridco is on strike, there's nobody in that room to bring the system up.
Then there is going to be a crisis.
Then there's going to be a crisis. The whole country will have to go down. That is my challenge, that you don't have a right to go on strike if you are in that position.
I'm Sivananti. This is Hot Issues. Well, and we have Kojo Poku, an energy expert, and the chairperson of the Senior Staff Association of Gridco, Raphael Kono, in the studio. We've been talking about Gridco and the challenges and the outcomes and the steps that led to the declaration of strike. We'll be back, and when we return, we'll explore some other concerns facing the energy sector. Welcome back to Hot Issues. I'm here with Raphael Kono, who is the chairperson of the Senior Staff Association of Gridco staff, and Kojo Poku is an energy expert. You wanted to react to something that Mr. Kojo Poku said.
I think before we break off, Kojo was saying that Gridco goes out there to take loan and government guarantee because we don't borrow on your own balance sheet.
Is that true?
If we were paid the debts we are owed,
you didn't have to do that. Yes. Then you wouldn't have to go out and borrow on somebody else's.
Exactly. And the guarantee does not mean that if you guarantee, you should stifle the organization from funds. You understand my point?
Yeah, I do.
I mean, recently, the AFD loan, which is being used to finance the 330 line, you know, Gridco has to come back to government because the financiers stop disbursing the money, and government has to guarantee. But it's at a cost. 0.05% of that cost also is a government guarantee fee.
Yeah.
And so eventually that fee also is added to the loan for Gridco to pay. So it's not for free that government guarantee. Even though government have the sovereign guarantee for it, Gridco has to pay. So Gridco must be well paid, or the debt that the Gridco is owed must be paid so that they can also pay their debt. And that is what we are saying.
So, Mr. Pujo, do you want to react to this?
No, I'm fine. I mean, I think the case is made.
I think you've made your point. He has made his point. Let's look at the broader picture of our energy situation today. A lot has happened within the short term. I mean, from the time Gridco staff declared strike up to today, a lot has happened, including the fact that the car partnership was moved from Tema to Sekendi Takoradi. Do you get the sense that we have an efficient energy system running that will guarantee that we'll have stable energy through to at least the next 5 years?
For now, we do, but the main bane of the challenge is under recoveries, and the under recovery, which is keeping on the debt piling up and piling up, and that is why we have this critical issue where what we take is not being utilized for the right, and the feeling is that it is not enough to go around and pay everybody. And the substantial of that chunk is the IPP's money that they take. That is why it was good news that Car Power now stopped using HFO and goes to Takoradi. In Takoradi, they now solve two problems. One, they go off the most expensive fuel, which is HFO, and start using gas. Gas means that we now, government have been able to reduce or negotiate the price lower, so we now have to pay lesser for what we are using. Then the gas which they are using, if otherwise had not been used, we have to pay the take or pay to ENI for not using the gas. So there is a chain of effect, chain of events that is happening with Car Power moving, which is good news for you and I. We would have seen a reduction in the price of electricity if we had not already factored that savings in the 2017 reduction that was done during Honorable Ejiakun's time. So the issue of Car Power moving is very good news. And the take or pay with the gas gets reduced. We use gas, which is much cheaper than HFO. And going forward, there will be more money left, so that the under-recovery, which is causing government not having money to pay the likes of Gridco, government might be able to have some wiggle room to be able to pay the likes of Gridco.
So, Mr. Kono, what do you want to see change with the way our energy systems are functioning now?
Well, let me just say a little thing about the Car Power. Mm. You know, when the Car Power was brought to Tema, Gridco has to look for money to construct another line to evacuate the power to the distribution center, the system control center, at a cost. Without
at a cost to Gridco.
Gridco.
Without Gridco asking anyone to bear that cost.
Because our mandate is to evacuate power from every generator that is sited anywhere in this country. And within a period of time, Car Power has been moved to Takoradi. Gridco has to construct another line. In fact, the first visibility study that was done was a shorter, but along the line, they have rerouted the whole thing. And it's like it has ballooned the cost of erecting towers to that point where the Car Power is located. And all this, Gridco is doing it on its own. Mm. And so, for me, I think going forward, we have been talking about this cash waterfall for the energy sector, where UCG collects the money, put it in a central pool, then a formula will be used to distribute the money to the energy sector players. Mm. And I think we have been talking about this way back from 2014, which never materialized.
You think this is the solution?
This is going to
be the nagging.
Maybe it may not be the ultimate solution, but it will go a long way to address the problem in the energy sector.
Mr. Boku, this is an idea you support.
Yes, definitely. The cash waterfall is something that was going to be implemented until PDS came in. PDS was of the issue that if they were going to put up the guarantees, which they don't take all the power, because bear in mind, the PPA sits with ECG, then what PDS was only taking a certain amount of the power and paying back what they take, and they were going to put in place a guarantee for the power they take. So they felt that there was no need to have the cash waterfall because they don't take all the power. Now that we have reversed the process and we are back to ECG without PDS, then we have to immediately revisit the cash waterfall so that, as Mr. Raphael said, we can now have everybody being paid, not necessarily ECG determining how much he gives Mr. A or Mr. Y. So each company would fairly feel that, look, what came in is X amount, I got my Y, I got my P, and I'm happy with it. PULC can also monitor that process and realize that if there are shortfalls, and they can now tweak the tariffs accordingly to make sure that enough comes into the pool. What you need to understand is that there are a few things that is happening in the energy sector. Again, gas is very key because now thermal makes up about 24% of our total generation. Hydro makes up about 24% of our total generation. Thermal is now the biggest supplier. So with all the power plants coming in, we need to have cheaper gas coming into our plants. In the past, we've complained.
And where are we going to get this cheaper gas?
Well, The issue with Tullo is a problem. I mean, issue with Tullo where they are dwindling reserves, where they are having to now take a reconnaissance of what they are doing. I hear there's going to be some layoffs at Tullo and stuff like that. But the forecast is good because there is the Springfield discovery, which there is some gas with the Springfield discovery, and that is a Ghanaian discovery, which that makes the outlook very good. So in some terms of medium to long term, we might get some gas coming from the Springfield discovery. Eni has a lot more in tank. They are not ramping up to the amount they could. We are not taking as much of the gas, so we need to explore. If we need more gas, we can get Eni to ramp up. And even if the Tullo issue persists, which they are not able to give us enough gas, we can now complement it in the long term with the Springfield field when they have the gas and the Eni ramping up.
So, Mr. Raphael Kone, the situation described by both you in terms of financing is real. But do you get the sense that governments, I'm not focusing on this government, do you get the sense that governments have put in place systematic measures that will ensure that your operations and the operations of the our other bulk power buyers will run smoothly?
Well, I think the system that could have been in place to make sure that these issues are addressed is the cash waterfall. And as I said, it started way back, I think, 2014. And for me, I think maybe there were some strings somewhere pulling those issues not to materialize. But I
believe political strings.
Well, I don't think political strings, but definitely the cash waterfall is going to be managed by players in the energy sector. And I don't want to believe that maybe somebody feel that if that account or that waterfall is set up, it will play to their disadvantage. So they may not make it work. And that is why I said maybe some strings are being pulled somewhere. Right. But I think it behooves on government to ensure that that cash waterfall come to being and is implemented as envisaged.
Mr. Kutupoko, I want to ask you my final question. I know you don't like yes or no questions, but let me take you back to the PDS issue. Government told us that the PDS power due brought fraud on Ghanaian citizens, but no one is yet to be held accountable for anything that happened in that fraud that government tells us about. Are you concerned?
I think that statement has been walked back a bit. I think the statement of fraud in that issue has been walked back, because what you need to do is you need to do proper investigation to determine fraud.
And you don't think that that has been done?
Well, the investigation, I think, is ongoing. Whether government, after the legal conclusion in the separation of us from, because you see, though we've terminated the contract with PDS, we need to get to legal conclusion where everybody now salvage relationships. There is something in the offing where I'm hearing that PDS want to take Energy Commission to court because they've not given them a fair hearing in dealing with their termination of their license that was given to them. For me, that's a story for a different day. But the issue is that government needs to look at all options. We've terminated it, we've gone away from it. There are talks of what's the way forward for the country in terms of ECG. And as my brother said, maybe the waterfall situation, which is part of the solutions going forward, has to be instituted immediately, because the government doesn't think that between now in December 2020, there is enough time to go down the concession route. So within the next 11 months, what can the government do for ECG? And I think the popular thinking, I think, is reform. What reforms can be put in place? Maybe we can convert some of the debt that ECG had to long-term debt, institute the cash waterfall that my brother talks of, and then look at management reform and putting in place some procurement structures in place for ECG. So restructure and all those things is what I think the popular thinking is between now and December next year. Maybe if the government do come back in 2021, right, they might have a different thinking of what they want to do. But for now, I think we just have to look at.
Thank you very much. And Raphael Kone, I must also thank you for coming. I want to take your final word. I needed to wrap up shortly, but it's fair for me to take your final word. This strike, will it ever be called off?
Well, we've suspended and we are watching with eager eyes as the promise that...
Right now it's suspension.
It's suspension.
Not call off.
No, it's suspension.
Okay. Yes. Right, so I'm Steven Enti, and thanks for joining us on hot issues. I've been with Kojo Poku and Raphael Kono, Senior Staff Association of GRIDCO. Thanks for your time.